Misha McAuliffe, they attempted several times to go in there. But we have concluded up to that point is first starting from Yedio, when Hashem knows all the Nibro, and their coming into existence is due to this knowledge. So therefore it should be that they should recognize the divine presence all the time, because this is what brings them into existence. And yet they do not have that consciousness, that recognition, to the point where they actually have bechira. They actually select their path in life completely on their own, based on their own judgment. To be explained that the reason for that is that this idea, the divine idea of the creation, is at the divine level, which is not sensed in the creation. It's on a higher level completely. So it's called, it's their behelim, in total behelim, because the creature, the creation, cannot sense the inner locus. And then it says further that there is also the inherent bitul in all the creatures, in the entire creation, especially in the Jewish people. There's a bitul to locus. And this bitul to locus is imperative. This is what defines a yid as a yid. It is a must be, and it is definitely present in every yid. And yet, it is of such a supreme quality that in the conscious recognition, there's no consciousness, conscious recognition of it. There's no way to identify a locus, even though a locus is what gives you chayus. The beetle, nonetheless, is an imperative. And it is this beetle that enables the Nibro to receive chayus from the locus. Ultimately, what this means, that the Nibro does have divine chayus, but he is not at all in cognizance what it is, because it is of a super quality. The whole time we're discussing, this whole discussion is focused on on the principle that everything is sourced and is actually brought into existence by divine intent. And yet, it itself is not conscious and not sensing this divine presence. Now we go further in Samacham. Another point that can be brought out in this regard. Based on what it says in the Kutitera with this mind. So it says over there, the Bechinas Ak, and these Bechinas of Ak Odom Kad, which we already spoke about, Odom Kadmein is that Odom level that encompasses the entire creation. The entire creation is identified within Odom Kadmein. It is a makif that contains in it all aspects of the creation. and all aspects of the creation emanate from that containment. Which means that Ak, this containment, this matif, is effectively that which brings everything to be in the world. And yet it explains in this Maimon Hashmimus, the Bechinas Odom Kadmi, that this Bechina of Odom Kadmi, Hagam Leishayim Beislapshus, although it is not possible to speak of his lapshus Bechinas Oipnim, that Odom Kadmi is Mislabish, is functioning and relating functionally in an Oipnimi manner. And we already discussed this last time, that he should be focused directly from that perch as to how things should happen. Opening in an involved manner. In other words, he should not only provide the ultimate goal, the ultimate significance of what is happening, but how it should happen in the world. In an opening manner, again, we already had plenty of misholim for this. So it, to be slavish between Sipnimi from Ak is impossible. Not Shayak, not impossible. Not Shayak. It is a completely different realm. It recognizes only the ultimate significance of what's happening, not how it happens. The komokoim, but yet still. Ha'oras gilui zeh, the ha'ora, the reflection of this gilui, of this revelation of the Odom Kadmon. Muchrach li yesh bi Yisrael, it's imperative that it should be by Yisrael. And I mean, this Rasovein, even the one ha'oras, ha'oras means the final effect. It is muchrach, it's imperative that every Yid in the Jewish neshama there should be a sense of the effect of this gift. To put it in simple terms, overstating in this simple simplicity, nonetheless, some kind of a approach. In Israel, it's imperative that there should be the sense that they are creations, divine creations. Their source, there's a source for them that makes them be. They are not entities unto themselves. This is an imperative sense in Israel. Again, this is oversimplifying, but nonetheless, from a worldly perspective, this is a great statement. And this is the ha'orah of this gilui. This is the ha'orah of this gilui. This is a reflection of this gilui that everything has a divine source. A divine source means it is the world. The world is not sourced in a worldly context. You cannot identify this world as to the process by how it came to be. This actually calls for the negation of the concept of evolution. Totally. Evolution means that you can trace within the world the context how things happen in the world. It's a totally misunderstanding what's going to But at a fundamental level, what's happening in the world is a divine presence, a divine effect, not a worldly effect. So Pnimi, as to the process of how it happens and all that, to identify that in Odom Kadma, in the market, is totally out of line. And yet, the Ha'orah of this Gilui, the Ha'orah, the reflection of this Gilui of Odom Kadma, and I said the Ha'orah of this is, yes indeed, I don't know how, but I do recognize that I'm a creation. This recognition, to recognize that there is a source, that I am a creation, and I live because my life is provided for me from a higher source, this is something which is imperative in the Shamas, in the Eden. Now let's continue later. The third line. From Hagoras Leshom Mevuot. And in the Hagoras and that Maimon, it is further elaborated. Shezei Inyan. That this is the principle that is reflected in the fact Mashik Knesset Yisroel Nikro Kala. That Knesset Yisroel. Knesset Yisroel means the principle of the Jewish souls, Knesset, that incorporates all Jewish souls. The basis of Jewish souls is Nikro Kalo, is called by the word Kalo. What is the word Kalo in gender and tale? Miloshin Kolson Apshin. Kalo is rooted in the word Kolson Apshin, is rooted in the concept of Kolson Apshin. Kolson Apshin means my soul goes out. My soul goes out to that which is superior to what I am. Sheyesh bekolecha v'yachad mi Yisrael.
What is Kala?
Huh?
Kala, what's the translation of the word Kala?
Kala comes from the word Kolson, going out. Sheyesh bekolecha v'yachad mi Yisrael. This calls on nafshi element that the soul is constantly rising upwards and wants to dissipate in its source is present in bekolecha v'yachad mi Yisrael in every Jew benitzus nishmose in the spark of his neshama likolel to be incorporated v'lidovek and to cleave, to unite, b'havayecho, with the one God. Contrary to what one may think, that the neshama wants to be an entity unto itself, it's the exact opposite. The neshama is constantly striving to become incorporated in havayecho. And to lose it, to give up, so to speak, its individual presence. They call it to be incorporated in Avaya. This is the ultimate of Ahab, to be one with the source. V'yahavozu, this Ahab. Of to cleave and unite v'ayechod. Yesh b'koyach kolach v'yachod v'yisrael. Is present b'koyach at the koyach level in every individual need. B'tmidus on a constant basis. The word bekoyach we already encountered, we already discussed. This ahava, this draw, the desire, this overpowering desire to be one with the Likus, is present in every yid, in every Yiddish neshama, and it's called bekoyach. Why is it called bekoyach? Because again, on a conscious basis, is not aware of this. We are aware of our worldly needs, of our worldly interest, or even in the world, even the learning and the experience, looking to seek experience and so forth. We're talking about our personal experience. We're not talking about being united with being one with the Likus, going out of our mitzvahs. We do not have that conscious experience. But bekoyach, in essence, this is what the neshama is. In essence, the Yiddish neshama is a spirit that is in constant draw and a constant thirst to be one with the Likus. Not to have any worldly definitions. That's what the neshama is. And this desire, this sense of kos nafshi, is by, in addition, neshama, v'kol echad v'yachad miYisrael betmidus. Betmidus means constantly. There's a constant desire like that. We focus in on the word betmidus, constant. Normally, when we define a desire, a draw, an interest, an interest means that you are now elsewhere and you draw, you identify something that you would like to have. But this something that you identify, you would like to have, is distant from you. You don't have it, you're not there. Therefore, since you are in a state where you're lacking this and you want it, that means that this relationship cannot be constant. You have to become aware of the fact that you want it. This awareness is in contrast to where you are now. Therefore, it cannot be constant. There's a moment when you don't have it, and then you become aware of it, and that's when you have it. A constant desire, a constant draw. Is of a quality that we cannot really fathom. But yes, the word desire, drawing out, and rising up and seeking something, means seeking something from a place where it is not. Therefore, it cannot be constant. Because since you're in a place where it is not, you have to become aware where you are and aware of what you want, and then it becomes your desire. To be a constant desire, you cannot be outside of it. What would be a kind of a mush, kind of illustration of a constant desire? the breath of air. Air is with us all the time. All the time. To the extent that we said many times that air actually pushes itself into our nostrils. So we do not experience what Hashem should never experience, a lack of air. Our recognition of the experience of air is not due to the contrast to not having it. It's having it. We also have an experience of what air is. And this is in a constant manner. Since, so how can it be a constant if it is the, how can you have a desire that is constant to the air? Air is there all the time. What does it mean? You want air. The answer is, explanation is, that life per se, if you can call it experience of life, which is a misnomer, but life per se, life is not something that our seichel can really identify. So all that, we are alive all the time, every instant. As we said many times, it's impossible to have an interruption of life. An interruption of life, God forbid, is the end of the person. So although it is there on a constant basis, and it is something which is, so to speak, given to us, freebie, like we said, the air pressure is pushing itself into us. Yet at the same time, we appreciate life. The reason we appreciate life is because this life is superior to anything that our seichel can perceive. We are alive, we don't know what it means. Therefore, this appreciation of life is constant because we constantly experience something which is superior to our understanding. And we are constantly desirous of it. So the reason we desire of it is not because we don't have it, but because we cannot fathom what it is. This desire is a constant in Jewish instructions. How can a desire be constant? Because the union of the kus is something which even the neshama cannot understand what it is. And the desire is so powerful and so overwhelming that what the Neshama wants is to be incorporated, to be one with the Ma'alakos, with the Ma'alakos. Not to be a recipient of it, but to be part of it. And this Ahava is present Bekoyach, again, Bekoyach, why is it called Bekoyach? Because this is an inherent thing, and this is not something which one becomes aware in his functional level. It is in essence of the neshama. Bekolecha b'yachad mi'yisro, b'tamidus, in constant state. A desire that is absolutely constant. And again, how can it be a constant desire? The answer is that you desire something which you cannot fathom what it is. And you still have that desire. Because that's inherent in your essence. Not because you experience its lack and you want it. To live is not a desire that comes as a result of recognition of its lack. But to live is a desire without sensing its lack, its absence. It's a constant desire. Why? Because it is a quality that is superior to our worldly existence. So while we are constantly having it, we're also aware that we want it. Okay, we're on the line that begins with the word bitmidus, which is the fifth line from the top of Eitz Samach. Now the Posek says, Laman is Amecho Choveid v'lo Yidei. Laman saw that in order that is Amecho Choveid, that he would express to you, Choveid, the glory, v'lo Yidei, it will never cease, never become quiet. It will constantly sing to you. And as the expression is in translation, Kori Todi B'loi Shok, it is calling, it arousing the source, the divine locus, B'loi Shokich, and it does not quieten down. It's constantly arousing the divine locus, B'loi Shokich, and it doesn't come quieten down. V'afiru B'bchus Yerech. And even in the lowest of people, Kusiyana, people who have a low esteem, Ve'amehoretz, totally ignoramus, and other people who are only worldly oriented. Even by them, Yeish Bechinozu, this Bechino is present. Because this is what the Nefesh is. Rakak said, this bechino, this desire and this draw is there by them also present all the time. Except that it is not his galus in revealed fashion, murgesh, in a sense, in a sensed desire. They know what they want, Tommy, all the time. They don't have a constant awareness of it. Rak musteres, it is just musteres, concealed, bibchinas makif, in a makif manner. It is a makif upon their existence. It is a makif upon all their thoughts, all their thinking, all their activities, and all their interests. Shoymer aleha mil mailo, it is guarding them, over them, milamayla from above, as a makif. so that they too have the sense of a constant life force, although they do not really comprehend what that is. And thus, for this reason, it is absolutely within the capacity of every yid to give soul up al kiddush Hashem for the sake of kiddush Hashem. Because that is what is bound up, what it is bound up with all the time. Bli shum tam, without any reasoning, v'das, or of awareness, hasogas elokus, of comprehending what he is giving up, he is giving his life for. He has no hasogas elokus. This is a constant capability in every heat. Rag b'chinas emuno. This is not an awareness by yid. It is b'chinas emuno in an emuna manner. The b'china of emuna. The word emuna means steadfast. Established in a steadfast manner, without the deviation, without the possibility of any kind of alternative. This is not something that a reed becomes aware by some kind of an intellectual process. Rather, it is a constant status in the Jewish neshama. Although he is, so to speak, aware of it, but the awareness is in a constant manner. Emun, hainu, which means, how does it become emun? It means shehi makifoi milmaila min haseich. Now this is what embraces the person, the neshama. Milamayla min haseichel, coming from that which is above the seichel, above contemplation, above awareness. It is not something which is a neshama process, internal neshama process. The root of this emuna,
What does it say in the parentheses?
I'm sorry.
What does it say in the parentheses?
Come on. It tells you to go and look in the Maimer, your Daita Piregimo.
Okay.
When it says the moon is a Torah, like a crown. The Sheirej of Amun and Shomish Yisrael. The Sheirej, the root of the Amun. And Shomish Yisrael, where does the Amun come from? How come the Shomish Yisrael have this Amun, this steadfast dedication? The root of that is actually Mishum the Mazlei Chozi. It is not something that the Neshama itself experiences, but rather it is the Mazel of the Neshama that sees it. Mazlei means, I don't know if I can say what it means. Muslim. We will translate it as the divine will that the neshama should be. The source of the neshama. There is in that process, in that state, the source of the neshama, there are two elements. There is the neshama as it comes into being, and there is the source that wants it to be. This source is a divine definition of the neshama. Prior to the neshama being, to be Muslim,